welcome back to Let's Interactively Play Steve Jackson's Sorcery. This is a Let's Play where at the end of the episode, you get to choose one of the choices presented, and majority vote will rule over what the next episode will be, what choice we will take. Unfortunately, we had a three-way tie, believe it or not, with the last episode. We came across these goat creatures, half human, half goat, and apparently one of them threw a rock at us, hit us in the head, and then they asked us, what is your business? So we had our choices are, who are you, I mean you no harm, or I discovered one of your companions. I had one person choose for each of those three. So I'm going to roll a d4 here on our virtual dice roller. Too bad there's not sound with it, included with it. If anyone knows of any, you know, dice roller websites or programs, anything like that, I prefer a website, actually. You know, downloading a program, but yeah, I want the sound of the roll. It's funny. So anyway, a roll of 1 will be to say, who are you? 2 will be saying, I mean you no harm. 3, I will say, I discovered one of your companions. And if I roll a 4... we will re-roll. So, see what we got. Re-rolling. Click to continue. 3. I discovered one of your companions. Interesting, because I was wondering how they would take this exactly. If they would believe me or think me guilty of that companion's fate. So, let's see. Okay, so here we are, and so these are what these creatures look like. What is your business, one demands. 2 creatures, each half human and half goat, perched against a southern slope, spears held ready. Here goes. I discovered one of your companions. One lowers her spear. Where? Okay, lowering the spear, good thing, good sign. In a cave. How was she? She demands. Her concern is clear. Well, I'm certainly not going to lie. She's dead. As expected. You must have discovered Shahimbli. She disappeared a few nights ago. She was very ill, and I suspect she left to prevent her disease from spreading to others. It is hard to hear of her fate, but I am glad you told us of her sacrifice. Forgive my curiosity, the second goat woman says, but where are you traveling from? Well, this is good. This is good. This worked out well. I've read a lot of stories and seen a lot of movies and such where it could go either way when you tell them something like that. She was very ill, so she had a disease. Hopefully we didn't catch her disease. Hopefully it's moved on after she died. Tell them something. Or it is none of your concern, or walk away. Tell them something. Oh, I'm going to tell them something. You take a moment to prepare a reply. Are these creatures servants of the Archmage? Or are they his enemies? You know, I'm thinking this would have been an even better choice to leave off last episode with, but since I'm playing this blind, I have no idea what's coming. I don't want to tell them about Annaland. The last person we told we were from Annaland said it's the Annalander, and you destroyed the Cockabad planes or whatever the hell. With no destination seems unwise to say. Why the hell would you be scrambling up these mountains with no destination? Although I've been truthful to them so far. I really don't want to reveal who I am. That might raise their ire. Because, apparently I am renowned for killing those lands. Even I'm not sure what is going on. I inadvertently killed them by using the towers or something. Well, I have a feeling that I am the past version of the Archmage coming to... I mean, if anyone knows, please do not say. No spoilers, please. Of course. So I'm going to tell them I'm from Kare, off to sell goods in Manpeng. I predict they won't believe me. You are going to Manpeng, she hisses, to profit off its misery? Manpeng has misery to profit from? It is not what you... It is not what you think. I would like an option to ask them what do you mean, Manpeng's misery. It is not what you think. A weak answer, the creature returns. Fair enough. We are an isolated people, but even we have honor. Unlike yourself, it seems. I meant no offense. Everything about you offends me, the creature replies. Oh, God. Enraged, the guards give a scratching yell and raise their spears, ready to throw. Perched above you, they have the clearest of advantages. We hoofporn never miss, one shrieks. What spells are available? Let me see. I'm tempted to just run, to tell you the truth. Teleportation, do not have that. Item, lightning. It's just an option against one of them, right? But, okay, nothing starting with X. It's a spell we don't know. Zap. It costs 3 stamina anyway. Invisible wall. That's a good choice, but it uses 3 stamina. How many? I do have 15. Just wanted to check. I knew we were down. We regained most of our stamina. Just wasn't sure how much. Okay. When you go back into it, the letters rearrange themselves. Okay. Illusion of treasure. Somehow I don't think that's going to impress them very much. Could be wrong. Open locks and doors. Why? I'm out in the open. Cause slowness to them, I guess. Was there something else for... No. Oh, I have... What's DOP again? Oh. Then what's... Slowness, okay. That's it. We've got W, D, X, which is nothing, and Z. Let's create an invisible wall. Looking to the stars, you craft your magic, throwing up an invisible barrier in front of you. Not a moment too soon. The hoofborn's spears fly through the air but bounce off the barrier. You are safe for now. I see no reason to taunt them. Let's escape. Well, I don't want to go... yeah, I guess that's a dead end, right? You race around the bend and arrive back at the main path. You hear clattering hooves as the hoofborn retreat upslope, no doubt preparing themselves should you be foolish enough to try climbing up to their position. The path runs in both directions across the chasm edge. Well, so much for making friends with them. Now that's them, right? So I can go this way? You walk along the edge of a sharp ledge which looks down into the deep chasm. The gap is wide, but across it you can see a path winding through the mountains towards Manpeng Fortress. Which is, miserable, right? I'm the bad guy. Is the Archmage the good guy? Don't know. It's very mysterious. A rope hangs suspended in mid-air above the chasm. Its near end is coiled up neatly on the path. The sun is beginning to lower and the air begins to cool. Look at the rope. You look suspiciously at the rope. It is dangling quite unsupported in the middle of the chasm. Down. You lean over, looking down the chasm. At the bottom, you can make out a rocky path that winds out of view. It is all but hidden below a layer of fog. I don't think we can get down there, can we? Not looking along the path. Looking to your right, you notice the trail continues. You think you see a bridge in the distance. So that's the bridge, and there's a rope here, I guess, which we cannot see. I see no reason to walk along a rope when there's bridges. At least two. So you're not even bother testing the rope. Which way now? Why this way? The rope is clearly a death trap. You leave it behind, walking towards the bridge in the distance. For a moment you seem to see something moving up on the slopes above you. You look up, but can see nothing. A hoofborn, perhaps? Watching your progress? Wave? You wave. A few... That was a 15. I don't think I took stamina damage from it. A few moments later, a rock strikes you on the temple, though you do not see if it was thrown or if it simply fell. I think it was thrown. Let's look at the bridge ahead. The bridge ahead seems strong and secure. It spans to a path on the far side. This must be the way the travelers to Manpeng took in times past. There's no reason to waste time here. Because, you know, I'm in exploration mode, trying to see everything. You head along the path until you reach the foot of a sturdy bridge that spans the chasm here. The sun begins to dip, heading toward the horizon. The bridge is made of plain wood and looks sturdy enough. Here in the dry mountain air, it has not even begun to rot. Time to move on, but will you risk the bridge without even testing the boards? No, instead I will go this way. There's some landslide up there, but I want to check it out. The wind picks up as the evening draws on. It will be night soon. Continuing around the side of the mountain, your hopes are lifted as the path up ahead pinches and curves back on itself. The chasm itself has shrunk to a small gap. Looking across the chasm, there is a rough path cleft into the far peak. It curves away out of sight, roughly in the direction of Manpeng. Judge the gap? The gap cannot be much wider than a stride and a half. With a decent run-up, you should be able to make it. My pebbles are special exploding pebbles. I'm gonna move away. You could turn back or follow the path around, or jump across the narrow chasm gap. Apparently there are many ways around this. I'm pretty sure this is not one of them, but I want to take a look at that rock slide or whatever, avalanche. The trail leaves the chasm edge to cut between two sheer walls of rock. The sun is sinking. You know, it's weird. I don't know if you guys can see that. Even see that. It's flashing. My little record icon. I don't know why. The sun is sinking and the sky is turning bruised purple. Soon it will be dark once more. A fleeting shadow passes overhead. Look up. This thing's flashing now quickly. Huh. I'm going to watch back my recording and see if anything's wrong. You look up quickly, in fear of the birdmen that patrol these skies. You were just in time to see a wide-winged shape wheeling out of sight. Perhaps it didn't see you? The trail winds a little as it goes. Okay, I'm going to be right back, guys, because I don't know what's going on with my recording. Hold on one second. Okay, It seems fine. I don't know why it's flashing like that. Alright, so we're continuing here. You follow the path along the ravine until you reach its end, where the path hairpins to follow the other side, but then your path is blocked. A large rockfall has covered this narrow trail. A steep hill of loose rocks and chunks of boulder stands in your way. You could perhaps run across it, but if the surface is unstable, you would slip into the ravine. Alright, I just wanted to see what would be there. Rather than taking any risks, you turn back. Now, taking another look at the map here. If we take this bridge, we end up going up, but it looks like... it looks like either way we could double back this way, because I do want to see what this is. Or I could just go back to this bridge. Plus, one of these bridges might not be sound. You never know. Plus, some kind of sunken citadel or tower here. And maybe a path down into the ravine itself. I'm gonna head back for this main first bridge anyway. You clamber back down the path towards the chasm. The sun has almost set and the sky is a deep pink. The trail winds a little as it goes. You walk out from the pass and back to the chasm ledge. Night has fallen. You would find somewhere safe to sleep, for if you keep going through the night, you'll be weaker for it. You should find someone. I guess that's not here. You could turn back or follow the path around or jump across the narrow chasm gap. Let's not jump. You make your way back down the winding path towards the foot of the bridge. The sun disappears. Time to move on. No, I will not risk stuff. You follow the mountain ledge. From somewhere above, you hear a calling voice. There's no reason to waste time here. You return to the edge of the chasm. The moon moves slowly across the dark sky. Okay, we buy that rope. Which way now? Maybe I can sleep over here. You return along the trail, heading away from Mampang. You're in view of the ledge once more. Which way now? The plateau. You return to a rocky plateau. The plateau is relatively sheltered. Okay, let's sleep here. You find an overhang of the cliff to lie down beneath. At least you have eaten already today, so do not need to eat again to avoid hunger, though more food will make you stronger. You will need to eat once a day to avoid hunger. Yeah, I need to find a way to cook those rations. You close your eyes and let your tiredness overtake you. The long night is filled with visions. You are standing on top of a tall, black-tiled tower, clinging onto its tiles with one hand, while with the other you wave something in the air. What is it? Okay, I gain back, what, 2 stamina, I think? You look in your hand to find you are holding nothing less than the crown itself, and then you hear a cawing sound, and a great shape moves towards you. A birdman? No. A gold-crested eagle, shimmering into view. The sight masters have seen you. They are taking you home. Rocky Plateau. During the past day, you explored the caves of High Zaman, ascended into the peaks of the Zanzunus, and found no new clues. The Archmage is waiting for you. You wake, stretching away sleep, and look around once more. There's no time to waste. Yeah, I've been wasting time, haven't I? Walking all the way up and down this thing. You return along the winding path. There is an unshakable gloom about this place. A few birds are singing thin and miserable songs. A jutting rock sticks out just by the edge of the ravine. Time to continue. A few clouds scud across the sky. You return down to the slope to the narrow bridge. Cross the bridge or move on. You must keep going. Alright, guys. Can I test the boards here? Yeah. Test the ropes and boards. You step onto the foot of the narrow wooden bridge. It is no mean span. The chasm is twice as wide as the Jabaji River, or Carry, at least, but the boards look intact enough. Test the boards. You wallop one of the boards with your foot, and it booms solidly. It seems firm, but you cannot know if all the other boards are as well preserved. Next, you tug the guy ropes firmly. There is plenty of slack due to the way the bridge hangs, but they are not loose. They must be tied well enough on the far side. Now, I try not to pray for aid often, so I'm gonna save it for when I might really need it. You have tested the bridge as well as you can. All right, let's go. Your knuckles are white as you grip the ropes and pace out onto the bridge. As the ropes tighten, the boards move downwards under every step, and it takes all your courage to take each step forward. Tug at the rope. Look down. Let's tug at the rope. You give the rope a sharp tug. It seems taut enough. The ropes creak and groan under your weight. You pause to look over the edge of the rope, then immediately regret it. It is not as high as the bridge across the forest of Snana, but with nothing holding you up by two lengths of fraying cord, it is considerably more alarming. I'm going to save my money and not drop coins. Standing still here is the worst option. If you're going to try to cross, you must be bold. Okay. Well, I can hear the creaking. That's awesome. You keep going, pacing board by board across the bridge. Then, without warning, one of the braided strands of the left-hand rope frays and snaps. The boards rock and sway violently, but the other ropes are holding for the moment. Let's run for it. There's clearly nothing for it but to run! You lurch forwards across the boards, and the pounding of your feet sends the bridge bouncing up and down sharply. Strand after strand of rope gives way. Jump! Jump! You try to jump. What? Oh no! But it is too late, and there is nothing to jump off from. Legs and arms waving maniacally. Manically, in midair, there is only one way to go. Falling. Yeah, falling. Oh, great. Down in the chasm. And or dead. You fall at high speed, the chasm walls rushing past. There is nothing to hold on to, and nothing to slow you down. No large birds swoop to rescue you. Only the ground can catch me. Okay, I have 14 stamina right now. When you hit the base of the ravine, the last noise you hear is that of your spine shattering into a thousand pieces. Yeah, I don't think we survived that. You have fallen to your death. Your adventure is at an end. Oh no, it isn't, Bunky. On the bridge. Keep running? You are too close to the far side to stop now. You keep going. The bridge swings sideways in wider and wider arcs, and then your foot steps out into empty space. Uh-huh. Okay. I guess I should have stopped. Either that or there is no choice that will save me. You stop still, trying to keep your balance as the bridge sways this way and that. There are mere moments left. Grab the ropes. Snatching wildly, you grab a rope in either hand and catch yourself just as the bridge breaks in the middle. You swing hard into the chasm wall. Still have 14 stamina. Climb up. From here is an easy climb up the ladder formed by the boards of the bridge. Finally, you pull yourself up and onto the edge of the cliff. For better or for worse, you have crossed the ravine. Wow. You are back on a firm rock path once more. Somehow we kept all our stamina. Look back at the bridge. The broken bridge dangles into space just a stride away, and its shattered boards litter the ravine floor. You breathe a sigh of relief. There is no time to linger. Alright. Let me head for this. This looks like the ruins of some kind of house or something. Oh, and there might be something else here as well. Westward path. Westward ho. You follow the path as it curves around the slope of a collapsed mountain, picking your way over fallen stones and tumbled boulders. This was clearly a major road once, but it has long since fallen into ruin. As the sun climbs towards its zenith, the winds pick up a little. Time to continue. Towards the peak. You follow the trail around the mountainside. Finally, the road ends outside a ruined building. The path beyond the building is nothing but rock and ruin. Enter the building. You approach the door to the building. It is not locked, but the frame has warped, and now the door is stuck, opened by a mere crack. The building is two floors high, with a tiled roof that has partially fallen in. Its main door is small, and set between large bottle glass windows. This was clearly a grand house once. A metal bracket sticks out from the wall above the door. Perhaps it once held a sign. Let's peer through the crack. You peer through the crack into the dusty darkness beyond. This place is clearly long abandoned. What kinds of spells? I guess for danger. You turn away, this place will have to be left unexplored. No. Didn't I click? You step away from the door once more. The only way is back. Didn't I click cast a spell? Maybe I clicked the bottom one next time. There is no J. Okay. We have open locks and doors, which I'm gonna use if we can't pull a door open. This is sense danger. Tempted, but clone myself. Fireball, I don't see a reason to cast that just yet. I'm guessing I'm not going to be able to open the door normally. Create wind. Yeah. Let us try to pull the door open. You slip your fingers into the crack into the door and try to haul it open, but the door is firmly wedged between the bent frame and the earth below, and it will not shift as much as an inch. Okay. In previous episodes, when I try to do things with my sword, it always damaged my sword to some degree. So I don't want to use that. Even though we should be able to choose which sword. It's probably going to choose my good sword and not the -4 sword. So I'm going to try this open doors and locks thing. Although I'm not sure if that will help in this instance. Because the door is not locked. You bind the starlight into shape around you, but the spell cannot seem to find purchase on the door. It seems the hinges have seized and rusted so badly, the spell no longer recognizes this opening as a door. Oh my. Well, I don't want to throw a fireball at it. That seems kind of crazy. What kind of door is this, anyway? Don't know. What else do we have? I really don't want to damage my sword. And yeah, I realize I could use the spell and then damage the sword and rewind, but that's cheesy. I don't like doing things like that. Cloning myself. So we can all pull the door, I guess? Danger. It's nothing but J. I guess a spell we don't know. That's fireball. Create wind. I don't think blowing the door with wind will help. I guess fireball. I really don't want to damage my sword. Watch it kill me. You weave the enchantment, winding a fireball in your palm. Blast the door. Then you hurl the fireball at the tavern door and explodes into charred fragments. Dust and stale air drifts out of the dim interior of the building through the doorway. Which way now? Unfortunately now, 10 stamina. Hopefully it didn't damage anything that we might be able to use. You pick your way through the buckled doorframe. Inside, you see a large room dotted with tables. Grass peeks up between the floorboards. The roof has collapsed in one corner, and ivy trails down the broken beams, settling on a long counter. Call out. Hello, anybody home? After you blasted their door with a fireball. Let's check behind the counter. You lean away over the counter, but there is nothing there except a row of barrels, all split open long ago with an axe. There's a rack of bottles that still seems intact, however. This must have been an inn. It sits beside a well-trod road, so travelers must have come this way at some point, but has long since fallen into disrepair. A mug sits on one table, its handle missing. Across the room, there is a cramped passageway. Look at the bottles in the rack. You look along the rack. Most of the bottles are wine or exotic ales, but one label catches your eye, fire water. But the bottle is dry as bone, as are all the others. Otherwise there might have been a really big explosion when we threw that fireball. Fire water. Let's search around. You make a quick search of the corners and the rubble piles, unearthing a moldering piece of paper and a few coins. Hopefully I can pick up both. Examine the paper. The paper is flimsy with age, the writing faded. You only manage to make out a few lines. The beckoning finger welcomes you, sorcerer, to the last resting place before the fortress. A hot meal is 2 bronze pieces and comes with a cup of ale. Bread and cheese are 1 bronze piece. It seems unlikely the prices are still valid, however, and there are no beacons here to help you rebuild the place. Oh, apparently we've got into enough trouble already with those beacons. Let's pick up the coins. Hunching over, you pick up the coins and examine them. They are very thin bronze, green with age. On the one side is a simple picture of a bird of prey, talons outstretched. On the other, there is a profile of a hook-nosed woman with a stern expression. There is writing along the edge of the portrait, but you do not recognize the language. Are they simply ancient, or from a faraway land? But in your travels to the past, you have never seen a coin like this, or another portrait of this woman. Currency of the bird creatures that are around the area, perhaps. What kind of spell? It's some kind of knowledge spell, but I don't think we have anything like that. See the future. Sounds like a good idea. Float in the air, I see no reason. Safe passage. Danger. Sense danger. Heal disease. I hope I'm not diseased. Read minds, there's no one around. At least, not that I know of. What was I looking at? See the future. I have that orb. You settle into a sitting position on the ground and take out the orb of crystal. Consulting the constellations above, you bind the spell and suddenly find yourself somewhere quite new. You see the tavern, but in good repair. A few travelers sit at tables, sipping drinks. You watch the door open and a young woman enter in, soaked through. The landlord beams at her. Awful night, yes? You headed to the fortress? She nods. Yes, I am to study. My name is Valaquesh. Valaquesh. I don't think introducing myself will do any good because I'm not really here, right? So I'm going to keep listening. You stay quiet and listen. Oh, good, good, replies the landlord cheerfully, putting an arm around the young woman. Plenty stay here on their way. Few return, but never mind that. Come in and rest. If you leave early tomorrow, you will be there before sunset. The vision fades as the woman accepts a bowl of stew. Was this an echo of the past, or a happier future? Well, we're supposed to be seeing the future. So either this place was rebuilt and that was the future, or this was the past from before it was destroyed, however that happened. You could explore the hallway or leave. Let's explore the hallway. You make your way down the hallway. It leads to several back rooms, but most have collapsed, and now only the nearest two are accessible. One is smaller, only containing a single bed. You look around the empty hall and discover a handle in the ground, a trap door leading to some kind of cellar, perhaps. The back rooms are almost certainly mere rack and ruin. I notice this isn't flashing anymore. That's a good thing. Oh, we have all these opportunities here. Large room, cellar, private room. I'm guessing we came from the bar. The rotten door of the large room yields to your touch. Brackish water seeps from the wood. In the room beyond are many beds, but they have been stacked against the wall. A chest lies open, its lock smashed, and one spot in the floor sags alarmingly. Look in the chest. You turn your attention to the chest first, but find nothing beyond splinters and dirt inside. The lock was smashed open some time ago. It has rusted into its broken shape. Check under the beds. Lying on your chest, you peer under the stack of beds. Straw spills out of the mattress onto the floor, and there's a pile of rags that you think is a rat's nest. A bottle lies amongst the filth. Grab it. You grab the bottle from the brittle straw. Pulling it into the light, you see it is a potion of fire water. What kind of inn sells potions? You stand, years of dust clinging to your dirt. To your dirt? Years of dust clinging to dirt. Clinging to your shirt. Uncork the fire water? I'm not drinking it. I'm uncorking it. You uncork the bottle and the smell, sharp and gingery, makes you cough and splutter. The fire water is still pungent after all these years. It must have been a good distillation. Would that give us a stamina or remove it? I'm going to cork it once more. Can I put it in inventory? You slip the cork back in and return the potion to your pack. Korga alone knows when you might need it. Potion of fire water. Alright. I might save it for a last ditch attempt or something. Examine the sagging floor, hopefully without falling through. You look at the sagging patch of floor from a cautious distance. It seems rainwater has pooled here and drained through year on year for some time. Am I going to fall through, or is there like a hidden like thing underneath? Step onto it? Oh god. You step onto the floor. It groans and buckles under your weight. The wood has rotted through. The floor collapses underneath you when you fall through. Oh, well, it's one way into the cellar. You land on soft dirt, staring up at the ragged hole. You sit up, seeing that you are in a cellar. A trap door provides a crack of light above. A large hole in the ceiling provides more. Look around. You peer around in the gloom. The floor is dirt with mushrooms peeking through, and in the corner a tree has managed to grow. It only reaches your chin, but you spy a few very small apples hanging from its branches. Pick an apple. You grab a single-looking apple from the tree and stow it in your pack. Good. Then we got actual ration now. Yay! An apple. Right. Examine the mushrooms. Could be food. Could be poison. Could be funky. Examine the mushrooms. The mushrooms are clattered or scattered around the cellar, glistening in the dim light and glowing slightly. There's a large cluster in one corner, which you squat beside. Pick a few. Again, that really... Yeah. I don't know if I should just blindly eat one. You grasp a few mushrooms clustered together. They are more entrenched than you would have expected. A small tug doesn't budge them. Watch, it's some creature under the dirt. You grab a clump of mushrooms and yank them out. The whole cluster comes up as one. They are all growing from the same source. You continue pulling and the object comes with it. It is pale and irregular, slick with dirt and moisture. You notice a fetid smell. Brush the dirt away. You brush the dirt away, the smell increasing. You knock a few mushrooms off, which bounce away across the dirt floor. Finally, you recognize the shape of what it is you are holding is a hand. You fling it away, a buried hand sprouting fungus. You peer closer. You cannot help yourself. The hand has mostly rotted away. The remaining pieces of dry, stringy flesh are colonized by the mushrooms. Who buried it here? And where is the rest of the body? The hand bears a ring of polished green metal. You slide the ring off the cold flesh of the finger. For a moment it sticks on the skin at the knuckle, but you work it free, imagining the chuckle its owner might have made. Then you slip it onto your own hand. It is cold. I didn't say put it on. I did not say put it on. Wait, what do we have? A ring of green metal. Well, it's in magical items, so it is magical. I have no idea what it's doing for me or to me. Let's climb back up. I guess there's nothing left to see in this cellar. You go over to the ladder and try to climb up, but the rungs of the ladder are rotten through. They turn to powder under your weight. You tumble back to the dirt. At least I didn't lose any more stamina. Call for help. There's no one here. Climb the walls. Unless I'm calling the Korga. You feel over the walls, try to climb out, but there are no holds, just crumbling dirt. But if you dig too hard, the building above will no doubt collapse on you. I'm thinking a hovering spell. Or float in air, or whatever. Yeah, it really has been running a while. Waiting for some, like, good choice to come up. Darkness? That's not gonna help anything. Create light? I don't know if there's anything that needs to be illuminated. That's, the other one sense danger. Zen for hover in air. Zen. Ooh! Teleportation requires a green ring, which we just found. That's awesome. Can I control where I teleport to? Explosions? Yeah, don't bring the place down on me. You know what, though? It didn't seem to help the wearer of the ring. Otherwise, I would use it. I would definitely use it. But that person died, maybe trying to teleport out of there, or he teleported in there, or teleported into the floor. Can you control where... Hold on. Because I don't know here. Spellbook. I don't know what direction it's in. So it counters this spell. Spell enables the caster to teleport a soft distance. Transportation can occur through soft materials such as wood and clay, but not through stone or metal. This spell requires a ring of green metal from crag and rock, which is the ring we just found, but is somewhat unreliable and can have disastrous results. Yeah. Let's not do with disastrous results. So I can hover in the air, which will take no stamina from me, and then maybe open that trap door. You wind the stars into order around you, and the medallion begins to glow as you rise gently up into the air. Okay, you float back up through the trap door and settle to the ground on the floor above. I thought we couldn't open the trap door. Yeah, we didn't make it. Trapdoor was closed, wasn't it? Mm. Well, that was interesting. You sigh with relief to be out of the cellar. You could explore further or leave. Let's check the private rooms, the only place you haven't been. Upon first glance through the doorway, the room at the back appears to be a private bedchamber, but as you enter, you see signs of violence. Unlike the larger dormitory, the furniture is smashed and possessions lie scattered about. Half a mirror still hangs in a frame, and pieces of splintered wood litter the ground. Hmm. Furniture is smashed. Look at the bed. The bed is the only thing truly untouched. On the bed, among the moth-eaten sheets, sits a note. Read the note. You pick up the note, I'm trying not to read ahead. You pick up the note off the bed and read it. Horrors, it reads. Surrounded by horrors, I have discovered this tavern is haunted. I must flee. If you read this, heed my warning. Run. Run now. A voice pipes up behind you. But it's fake, you know. A fake? Sorry to disappoint you, replies the voice, but he'll be more disappointed if you aren't scared. And you shouldn't be. Turn around. You turn around, but no one is there. Still, the voice pipes up again, this time from the hallway. He worked on that for a whole afternoon, it says. It sounds like a young girl. Show yourself, you call. I'm out here. The voice responds from the hall, then giggles. Come and get me. Well, I do want to look around the rest of the room. You wait in the room, hand straying to your blade. Nothing happens. Are you still there? The voice asks. I hope you are. I've had no one to talk to for so long. Okay, leaving the room, I'm guessing into the hall where the voice is coming from. There's no other way out of this room. And nothing more to find. Well, I didn't examine the furnishings and stuff. And you said there was possessions strewn all about. I want to see what that is. You head from the room and back into the hallway. In the hallway, a young girl is standing, her hands clasped in front of her. Her flesh is slack and tinged green. One eye is missing, and her patches of hair are like straw. She smiles up at you, but her chest is quite still. She is not breathing. A ghost. The ghost dances from foot to foot. Terribly hard to write a note in our condition, you see, but he managed it all the same. He's stubborn like that. The furniture was easier. I helped a bit with that. She stares at you and a worm crawls out of her empty eye socket. Okay. Then she's not a ghost. She is... She has substance for a worm to be... on her. It slithers across her face and burrows into her ear. Unless a ghost, it's also a ghost worm. She is not the first ghost you have met, of course, but she is in somewhat worse condition than Larag was when you met him at the gates of Kare. What are you talking about? My friend Fildrick, she says. He's around here somewhere, though he sleeps more than I do. But I wouldn't worry. Was that your hand I found in the cellar? You ask. The girl looks appalled. Did they bury me in the cellar? That's horrible. They could have at least burned me. Is Fildrick dead, too? Oh, yes. Very much so. He died after I did, I think. How long ago was this? She wrinkles her nose. Hard to say. A long time. I remember the tavern being full of laughter and travelers, but that was after I died? It might have been. How did you die? You ask. Oh, it's too horrible to cheerfully. Oh, it's too horrible to repeat, she replies cheerfully. The note said this place was haunted. You tell her. The note is a fake, but not that part, the girl replies. It is haunted, but we're not horrors. Could I ask you a favor? The girl says, the worm peeking out of her ear. Go ahead. Oh, thank you. I have been trapped here for so long, but I believe you can help free me. Then a voice booms from the front room. Stop right there. Fildrick, I presume? Just then a second ghost strides into the hall. Look him over. He is, or was, a well-built young man. A hooded robe, now in tatters, clings to his frame. The skin of his arms has frayed like cloth in places, and white bone peeks through. "You will leave," he shouts to you. "Never return. To stay is to invite death. Didn't you read the note?" "Nonsense," the girl retorts. "This mortal can help us. We could be free." "If I can help, I will." The girl's eyes light up. "Imagine being free, Fildrick," she cries. "Going out into the sunlight, seeing new people." Fildrick rubs his face, the skin flaking slightly. "No, no, we cannot leave." "Why not?" I cannot remember." He looks at you with hollow sorrow. "But I know it is important that we stay at the inn." "Why have you forgotten?" "Death. There are many things I cannot remember. The girl remembers more than me." "Will you help us?" the girl pleads, turning her big round eye sockets at you. Fildrick shakes his head. "No, no. You must leave. We are the dead, and you should be afraid of us." "What keeps you here?" "An old spell," the girl says, "but a simple one." "Who cast it?" Fildrick coughs. "Someone old. No, someone long ago, a spell of binding across the threshold, to keep the spirits within." "Were you present at the casting?" "Yes, I think so. I think I was alive when the spell was cast. I do not remember if the girl was." The little girl spins in place. "Who can say?" Okay, guys. Been running for almost an hour. This seems like a good choice. What are we going to say? I do not trust you, Fildrick. Or I do not trust you, little girl. Which one should we not trust? So, yeah, only two choices this time. Let me know what you guys think. Cast your votes. Let thy vote be counted. Thanks so much for watching, guys. See you in the next episode. This is taking a pretty interesting turn, I think. So yeah, see you next week, guys. And yeah, thanks again. And endure. In enduring, grow strong. See you next week.